And he said, my presence shall go with thee, and I will give thee rest. Let me die the death of the righteous, and let my last end be like his. The eternal God is thy refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. The Lord gave, and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Though he slay me, yet will I trust in him. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in our time of trouble. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous runneth into it and is safe. Behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid, for the Lord Jehovah is my strength and my song. He also has become my salvation. Shall we pause for prayer? Almighty God, the giver of life, today we give you thanks for Eli and for the impact he has made on our lives. Pray, Almighty God, for your comfort even now as we say goodbye. May you, O Father, surround us. May you undergird us as we travel this road of grief. We ask these mercies in Jesus' name with thanksgiving. Amen. Please have your seat at this time. We want to, on behalf of the family of our dear brother, say a very special welcome to all of you to this service of thanksgiving. Let me also, on behalf of my own family, offer to you our condolences. We know Eli was a very affable man. Guy who could find the funniest of everything. And so we're going to miss him sorely. But today we give God thanks for his life and for his legacy. We're going to sing our first hymn this afternoon. Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. I'm going to invite to lead in the service Mr. John Bino.
Let's all stand as we sing this wonderful song.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, from above. Echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior.
We're going to have some tributes, and I want to encourage you, those of you who are doing the tributes. We're going to first have Mr. Peter King, and then we're going to have Jason Giddens, and Godfrey Martin will read also a tribute from Patricia Worrell. I want you to come after each other, and then I'll come again and introduce the next item. So at this time, I'm going to invite Mr. Peter King to come and share his tribute.
Good afternoon, brothers and sisters. A couple of months ago, I was right here doing a similar thing. Then it was called Words of Remembrance for my cousin's partner. And one of the things that impressed me was the fact that we hardly speak now about the mourning, the passing of someone. We speak more, in my opinion, a positive way about the celebrating the life. And if ever, ever there was a life to be celebrated, it would have to be Elli Augustus Williams. The pastor referred to him as affable. Yes, but he was also a first-class comedian. Elli made you laugh at everything. I'd never seen him vex or displeased, always laughing. And our association is roughly about 25 years. I met him at a business that he was doing deliveries for, and I was doing sales. And as Bajans would say, our spirits mesh. Elli called himself, as typical Trini, a calypso aficionado. And you could hear him on evenings, probably around the same time now, discussing with Larry Mears on Larry's program, some topic, some issue dealing with calypso. He also had a very strong command of the English language, and every once in a while he would drop, as Bajans would say, a big word on me. And I would say, oh, hold it, let me digest it, just give me a chance. And likewise, he would do the same to me. my job required me to go to six roads. And there was Eli sitting at his newsstand, nations primarily and a couple of the advocates. But one thing was distinct. Everyone that stopped at that stand, walking, riding a bike, riding a motorbike, any vehicle, there was always something humorous passing between Eli and them. And remarkably, he knew what they used to bring to pay for the paper. He would walk with the change in his hand before he got to the car. And most often, he was accurate. He loved his cricket. And we went to a couple of CPL games, and as usual, Eli had three flags, Barbados, Trinidad, and I think it was Antigua. And I would always go on the opposing side just to make things even more heated. But that circle, that section wherever Eli was rocking all during the game, all during the game. He just could not stop that. He liked his African heritage. And the program has a picture, I think, is up on the right-hand side. He had on this fancy shirt, and he sent it to me on a WhatsApp. And he called himself in the caption, I can't even pronounce it, Prince Ogodugu, from some African tribe. His wife might know who I'm talking about, Prince Ogodugu. So all that night, I said, okay, Prince, do I have to genuflect? What do I have to do when I'm speaking to you? Oh, well, you are my friend, so you'll be allowed to pass without any hindrance. I noticed over time that he was coughing a lot. And sometimes we had to stop our conversations because he couldn't speak. He was gasping for breath. I called to find out how he was doing. And his wife said to me, Peter, I'm sorry to tell you, but Eli is in hospital. And I said, okay, well, remember to him for me. He said, well, he has his phone and so on, but I felt uncomfortable calling, not sure what his state was. But then he came home, and we started talking again. And Eli said something to me that, on reflection, I started to wonder about it. He said these words, if anything happens to me and I have to leave this place, I want you to speak. I hesitated before I responded. I said, what? He said, you heard me. I said, yes, I did. On the hymn sheet that we have today, the program, there's a hymn, It Is Well With My Soul. And a friend who incidentally knew Eli sent the story of how that hymn came into being. And as they told you, tell you, share it, send it to 6 people, 10 people, whatever. I sent it to Eli. And on reflection, I wondered if it was just happenstance or if it was God's intervention that he should tell me this. And a few days later, I'm sending him a hymn, It Is Well With My Soul. I will miss him immensely, because as his wife could attest, he would call me 8:30, I'd call him 8:15, and we talked at about 10 o'clock on everything, regional, local, global. I assured you if he was alive, we would be talking about the check. I guarantee you that. We would be talking about the Miami fiasco. You know that what that is. We would have been covering that from all angles. This was the type of person who Eli was. At this juncture, I would like to take this opportunity to thank his wife for allowing me to be here to do this, and to extend to her and her family and friends from my family our condolences and likewise for the friends of mine who knew Eli. And I am sure that wherever he is, there's fun and laughter. That was the nature of the man, Elli Augustus Trini Paperman Williams. And I thank you for your indulgence.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Jason GITTENS. I am actually a part of Eli's second son. I remember when we had his staff party at Hilton, and his wife and I, and his wife and Eli used to go by comedy staff party has finished. We used to go by the back of the garrison. And he said to me, man, I hope you ain't gonna look for Natalie, you know. And he said to me, Eli, I done with that. I done with that. I don't want to deal with that no more. Yeah, I mean, my goodness, man, don't tell me that, goodness, man. Don't tell me that. Don't tell me that, man. And our friendship grew at years to come. But when I was working at Roberts, I went to Roberts at 2010, and I get laid off, and I come back to 2011. Our friendship had been grow many years, and I take Eli at my home. And Eli and I, tell me, Giddens, man, you got a big house, but you got, I said, me? This ain't my house. This is my parents' house. No mine. No mine. You got that girl in here. You got that girl here, though. I thought you like, man, I saw enough, I bring you in. I saw enough, bring you in. Let me make this, man. You know how me is thing, man. Actually, my father and my parents love Eli. And my father was playing the sparrow, the mighty sparrow. And Eli used to dance and moving balls and saying, yes, and all kind of things. Okay. And when I heard Adrian call me on my cell phone and told me that Eli had passed, I said, I couldn't believe it. I said, Eli? Even told my mom that I was planning to go up for Eli. I said, but being my job at Roberts, I said, I never had time to go up for him. But we had to communicate on Facebook and stuff like that. And I went by his house, and his son was outside. And he said, man, sorry about your father, man. Let me, man, you know, that's what it is. But as me and I was very, very close friends. And don't talk about drinks. We went by Shirley's shop afterward. Evening. And don't tell me. Don't tell me. They said to me, my goodness, man, come and have a drink, man. I said, listen to me. Are you driving, you know? You were all right. You ain't driving me. If you drive me, I give you the keys here. And then we met across by the shop in the church parlor that we met his daughter for the very first time. And you know, and we start talking. They said, get in, man, come on, have a drink. Come on, have a drink, man. I said, me, listen to me, put two beers there for me, and that was that. I got to get home. You know, and Eli was a very gentleman. He was a people's person, and he is a mighty giant. And I could not believe that he had gone. But he's at the resting place. And as I was saying, that it's Eli. I wish you were here now, that we could talk now, boy. Father, I say on behalf of Robert's manufacturing team, and on behalf of the GITTENS family, my parents, myself, Adrian Hardigan, GITTENS, Carson GITTENS, and all the rest of my family. Mrs. Williams, thank you for giving Eli and Robert's manufacturing team. He is a very, very good gentleman, and he also like a father figure to me. And Mr. Eli, you take care of yourself, buddy. And you know, don't worry, we'll get to heaven. Me, Adrian, we're gonna send her a bottle of whiskey, man. We're gonna send her a bottle of whiskey and four beers. And four beers. Oh, and besides, too, say hello to Ronald and Burnham for me. And all the rest of the staff that have had to pass on through the years. Thank you.
Good afternoon. This tribute is from Godfrey Martin. Remembering Eli Williams, a life and journey well lived. As 2024 unfolded, we lost Eli Williams, a son, husband, father, brother, close friend to many, and a warrior for Caribbean unity and uplifting our culture. Eli transitioned and joined the ranks of our ancestors on January 2nd, 2024, in hospital in his adopted homeland of Barbados. I first met Eli around 1967 when I came to live at Rushford Street while attending San Fernando Government Secondary School. Our paths crossed when a young Alsatian under my care ran away from home and found refuge at the Williams household where another dog resided. I was chastised by the Williams brothers, who suggested that I was not properly caring for the dog. Notwithstanding this initial encounter, we started to chat, as young men do, and found out more about one another, and this started a long-lasting friendship. The Williams household was visited by many of us growing up in the area. The front of their gate and the roadside became a lightning spot for many of us in the area. This is where we held court on different topics. A key personality emerging in all of this was the late Dennis Sprangeline Hall, who shared his wide knowledge and love for the Calypso art form. And this greatly influenced us all. Eli was a regular player in the annual Ole Mass competition, as the Blanche Fraser group would mount a band under the leadership of Royal Amy and Dennis Sprangeline Hall. Royal remembers Eli as an extremely good storyteller with impressive talent, like a good actor using all the personal attributes to reinforce his storytelling. This was evident in his Ole Mass portrayals on the streets of San Fernando. In the early 70s, Dennis and I, who were members of the Drama Guild, went on to help in the formation of the Performing Arts Technical Team, PAT. This group was involved in stage management, set and lighting design, and effectively undertook all the technical aspects of theater production. Eli and his brother joined us, and they became treasured and loyal members of our group. Eli worked as Pat's liaison stage manager with the Eugene Joseph Dance Group. Eli subsequently took over from Pat as the stage manager for the Prime Minister's Best Village competition. He also became stage manager for the government national cultural contingents traveling abroad for events like Carry Festa. He was well appreciated and respected by the leadership and organizers of these events. He always displayed an ability to communicate well with others, no matter their station in life. He was self-confident and ready to learn new things. He got married on August 20th, 1983, to Sonia, a beautiful Barbadian lass, and eventually crossed the seas in 1990 to make Barbados his homeland. He was always a good host to family and friends visiting from abroad. He never gave up on his homeland as he made annual trips to connect with family and friends. Even though I moved abroad in 1988, we kept in contact whenever I returned to the region. It was always the highlight of my trips to pass through Barbados and hook up with Eli. We had a memorable time last year when he showed me all over Barbados, and through his efforts, I was able to locate a second cousin in the St. Joseph Parish and also one near Bridgetown. I noted the love and respect that many people had for him. I remember they called him Trini in the marketplace in Bridgetown, where he introduced me to others from other Caribbean territories who had adopted Barbados as their homeland. Eli was clearly well-liked in the community in which he lived. He was a progressive thinker, and his love for arts and culture was deep. His knowledge of the calypso as an art form was profound. He remembered many a tune from the heydays of the calypso tent. His memory of our Blanche Fraser community was encyclopedic. He could recall all neighbors who lived in our area. He had a common touch and made sure that we kept our feet on the ground and understood the working class reality. I always treasured his opinion on many matters, particularly about the situation in our Caribbean region. He was a self-taught intellectual. He brought depth to analysis and had the ability to offer alternative insights to many discussions. Eli's favorite quote was, "Don't overdo, don't underdo, do what you have to do, and do it well." This is an apt summary to his approach in life. He has been consistent and did what he had to do well. Eli loved his family and worked hard to build and support them in all they did. He noted in his Facebook page that the dictionary defined Eli as a man who can treat a woman like a queen. I am sure his wife would attest to that. He lives to mourn his wife Sonia and children Sonnel and Ellison, his birth mom, siblings, and the wider Williams family. This is indeed a big loss for his family, friends, and for his community. I will miss my close friend. We broke bread together, and we shared many happy thoughts. It has been 12 years since his twin brother, Elias, passed. The grouping from our Blanche Fraser line in San Fernando has dwindled, but the memories remain. Deepest condolences to all who were near and dear to Eli. Our lives have been enriched by his presence and his humanity. I mourn his passing. Farewell, my friend. May you rest in peace. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm sure that all of you who knew him recognized that he was one who would be able to speak to anyone and share. I too experienced having stopped at the little stand for a paper. And I can agree that once, he didn't know me because I don't do it regular, but he had change. He had a change for what I wanted. So we want to right now have a musical tribute. It's a steel pan selection, Goodbye by Joel Williams. I encourage you to keep those memories, because memories are something that can last a long time. Some say it lasts forever, but they're good memories, they're bad memories, as the bridge in this song says. I can remember all those great times we had. There are so many memories, some good, some bad. Yes, and through it all, those memories will last forever. This time I want to invite Janell Adamson to come and read the eulogy.
Good afternoon. Everybody think I can't get this done, but I have to do it, so we gotta do it. So here we go. Hey. Most of you would know my father as Trini, Trini man or paper man. To me, he was Eli, my daddy. If you really know me and my brother, we rarely called him daddy though, unless we wanted something. We weren't disrespectful, it's just how we grew up. So Saint Eli was just as normal. I remember one time we were in town and someone heard us calling him Eli and said, "You let your children call you by your first name?" And quickly replied, "It's my name, ain't it?" My father loved to talk, but not just any foolish talk. His favorite topics were politics, religion, cricket, women's tennis, only if the Williams sisters playing, and music. Even while in the hospital, Eli had a whole 20-minute conversation about politics and what the Prime Minister was and was not doing. But with all his talking, he instilled many words of wisdom. Some of his memorable quotes were, "Time longer than twine," "Beware the fury of a patient man," and "Be wary of a liar and a thief, because a thief tells lies and a liar will someday thief." My father always used to say, "With great power comes great responsibility," and often dropped some life gems. And if I didn't understand them, he would say, "You will get it when you're older," or "You'll want to remember what I said." And he was right. He was a member of Trinidad Performing Arts Technical Team, a member of the San Fernando Arts Council, and also a stage manager for Best Village. His heart was deeply rooted in arts and culture. Music flowed through his veins. He loved all genres of music, from classical to jazz to oldies, but his favorite genre was calypso. My father loved calypso with every fiber of his being. In the days of cassette tapes, my father had boxes and boxes of tapes with recordings of Panorama, Trinidad Soca Monarch, Power Soca, and Barbados' Pick of the Crop Finals, and much more. It was a sin to interfere with those tapes ever. I fondly remember many a Saturday afternoon after my math lessons having to go into S.Y. Adams to purchase TDK 90-minute tapes for him. Some of his favorite artists were Baron, Sparrow, Lord Kitchener, Swallow, Colin Spencer, Gabby, Invader No. 3, and Smokey Burke. But he truly loved Black Stallion, and he would constantly extend his arms and quote these seven famous words: "Tonight, you black man feeling to party." My father had a vast knowledge of music and never hesitated to share it. He would often be heard on the fireworks program with the late Dennis Johnson, or on an evening with Larry Mears, taking him down memory lane, or having conversations about which artist or song would be the top runner in the year's Pick of the Crop competition. So of course, his love and knowledge of music sparked my love and knowledge of music, with my favorite being soca. Eli was a lover of life. He always said, "I love to knock about, not your mother." He would randomly take a bus from the Fairchild Street bus terminal and just do what he called a tour, where he would, as he said, learn something new about Barbados. He loved history and reading and learning new things. Know that you say this? I don't remember. On his birthday, we went to Harrison Cave. And my father said, for all the years living in Barbados, that's the first time he ever went to Harrison Cave. Eli made friends easily and left his mark no matter where he was, from his days as a supervisor at Shell Warren's gas station, or as the machine assistant at Roberts Manufacturing, or even when he retired and sold newspapers in Four Roads, St. Philip. Everyone knew Trini. He would sometimes say, "I know half of Barbados and the other half know me." He believed in having a solid education that included knowledge of your history, because you can't go forward if you don't know where you came from. So, Ellison and I had to attend the library every other Saturday and borrowed 2 books each, and he must check them before we left because we could not take up any baby books. We also had to write book reports on them. We had to read newspaper articles out loud, and when he came across a new word, we had to check the dictionary for the meaning and the thesaurus for a similar word. Eli always told me that he prayed hard and long for his first child to be a girl, and his prayers were answered. But I don't know why he always dressed me like a boy. There were only 2 things I remember that my father didn't go to. That was doctor and dental appointments. He would provide the money, however, because his philosophy was that he must provide the things his family needed. He didn't believe in giving Ellison and I everything we wanted, only ensuring that we had everything we needed. Like the time I wanted a pair of the famous Timberland school boots from a well pair. Eli said, nope, those shoes are only fashion, and I had to get a pair of the ugly bulldozers instead. But they lasted the entire school year, no matter how I kicked them about. Or the time Ellison had wanted some toys, and he said, you already have enough at home. But he made sure Ellison had every single item needed for karate, from helmet to shoes, bags, mat, etc. We never had to worry about school fees, school books, clothes, or even food. It was always provided no matter what. He was a great father. The best father in the world, actually. He was around and present for everything in our lives. Never missed a school function or a PTA meeting. He was even a father figure to our friends, always made them feel welcome. Some of them used to tell me Eli is the father that they never had, always sharing wisdom to guide you on the right path. But my father was cheap. Or, as he was saying these times, frugal. He bought nothing that was in fashion. Always said fashion doesn't last and you should shop for durability. So you can definitely tell he never owned anything from Tommy or Michael Kors. Always asking, do they know me? Well, I don't know them. One story that I always told people about my father is when he used to take us into town shopping, and Ellison knows this well. We would get out the van by the main guard, walk back to the bakery that was called Chef's Gâteau, where Eli would purchase a slice of rainbow or chocolate syrup cake for Ellison and myself. So we could eat the cake there, and then we would share a bottle of frozen water that he brought from home, or we could keep the cake until the shopping was finished, and then he would buy us a drink. So the drink was a Sister Marshall snow cone. So sometimes you could only get the cake or the snow cone. So you had to make up your mind. My father's favorite store was S.Y. Adams, and that's not a lie. He was a philosophical man. He was a kind man. He was a hardworking man, a disciplinarian, a no-nonsense man. He was a witty man. He was a charming man. That charm won my mother over and turned him into a loving and devoted husband. They married in his homeland, Trinidad, on August the 20th, 1983, and celebrated 40 wonderful years together in 2023. I love seeing my parents together. The love my father showed my mother was definitely top tier, with random surprise gifts and lots of public displays of affection. He would often say he's teaching his children. He's teaching Ellison how to treat women, and he's teaching Sonnel how a man should treat her. Transitioning to Barbados must have been the hardest thing my father ever did, but he definitely made the best of it. He made sure we knew about his Trinidadian culture and that we knew our Trinidadian side of the family. On his yearly returns to home, Trinidad, he would ensure he visited and checked in with his mother, Maida, his nieces, Prudence, Lisa, Andrea, Giselle, Denise, Simone, and Kamika, and his nephews, Dwayne and Paul, as we know him as Bertie. Dwayne said he would truly miss his laughter and his witty talk, and said he was a great uncle and a friend. My father's energy was infectious, so everyone just loved him. I can honestly say I would truly miss my father. From hearing him call me his favorite girl child as if he had another, or that deep, hearty laugh at one of my silly jokes or antics, to him telling me that he loved me at the end of our phone calls. He believed that we are all a part of this great universe filled with a higher power, and we are mere mortals whose spirit will remain alive as long as we're remembered by our loved ones. Well, Eli, your spirit will definitely remain alive, for you shall never be forgotten. Keep singing until our spirits meet again. I truly had the best daddy. I love you.
We can learn a lot from Eli, from that eulogy. At this time, we ask you to stand again as we read God's word, John chapter 14. We're going to read from verse 1, verse 7. It's going to be done by Janelle Reece.
Good afternoon, everyone. This version is a little different from what is in your leaflet. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going, Thomas said unto him. Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really know me, you will know my Father as well. From now on, you do not know him and have seen him. Here ends the reading.
And thank you. We may stand as we sing this wonderful song of the church, How Great Thou Art.
No.
standing for the second reading. Revelation chapter 21, verse 1 to 7. It's going to be read by Ms. Tracey Gibbs.
Good afternoon, everyone. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away." He who was seated on the throne said, "I am making everything new." Then he said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." He said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. Those who are victorious will inherit all this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children." Here ends the reading.
Before we hear the address, we're going to sing one last song. Still.
Oceans rise and thunders when the oceans rise and thunders roll, I will soar with you above the storm.
Oh, yes, I will.
Father, you are king over the flood. I will be still, know you are God. When the oceans rise and thunders roar, I will soar with you above the storm. Father, you are king over the flood. I will be still, know you are God. When the ocean flies and thunder flows, I will soar with you above the storm.
Amen. Be still and know that I am God. That's what God says. And I want to invite Reverend Kelman at this time to come and share God's word. Pray to him, open your hearts to listen as God speaks to us.
Shall we pray? May the words of my mouth, my attention of my heart, be accepted in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our deliverer. You may be seated at this time. Saying goodbye is never an easy thing. Whether it's goodbye in terms of migration or goodbye in terms of death, saying goodbye is always very difficult. And then we reflect on a man like Eli who sought to brighten his corner wherever he was. Then that makes it doubly difficult. But I want to, in the words of St. John, to say to you that death is not the end. For in John chapter 14, we observe that Jesus Christ was saying to his disciples, he was going away. The one who had fed them, the one who had stayed with them, the one who had sought to lead and guide them, the one who was always present the lives for the last 3.5 years, was leaving them. And they were torn to shreds. And Christ, in his attempt to comfort them, he said to them, I'm going away. I'm going to prepare a place for you. And so I want to charge you and to suggest to you this evening that there is life beyond the grave. For he says to them, I'm going to prepare a place for you. In my Father's house there shall be many rooms, and each person will have their name inscribed on one of those rooms. And then we read Revelation chapter 21 that seeks to clarify what Christ began to share in John 14. And St. John Divine, he says to us that this mansion shall be located in the New Jerusalem, a new place. A new place where there shall be the presence of Almighty God. And John sought to give us a glimpse of the grandeur and the beauty of this new place. He says it's a new place that will resemble that of a bride who is in preparation for her husband. And we know that brides take pristine care to ensure that every stitch, every pleat, everything is in place for that special day, even if it keeps the groom and the minister waiting for 2 or 3 hours. They want to ensure that all is well. And John uses that as the illustration to demonstrate the beauty of this new Jerusalem. But more than that, he says, in this new place, there shall be the presence of Almighty God. And we need to understand that in the Garden of Eden, there was a sense whereby Adam and Eve experienced great and hallowed fellowship with their God. As a matter of fact, it tells us that God came down in the garden in the cool of the day, and they had such sweet and wondrous worship. They talked, they engaged, they had a wonderful rapport, but then the word of God says to us in Genesis chapter 3 that sin entered the human family. It was an intrusion and created separation between God and man. As a matter of fact, we're told that when God came down the garden, Adam and Eve began to hide from God. They began to run from God. That which was once sweet and hallowed and a welcoming presence became that which they could not tolerate, and so they ran from God. And hence that separation began. But thanks be to God, in this new Jerusalem, in this new place, the presence of God will be there. Such sweet fellowship, which Adam and Eve would have experienced before the fall, will once be restored in that new Jerusalem. John Milton wrote an epic play called Paradise Lost and Paradise Restored. The Word of God says to us that in that new place, with that new presence, that paradise will be restored. As it was in the beginning, so it shall be in the end. A new place, the new presence of Almighty God. The word tells us that in that new place there shall be no longer any pain or hurt or grieving or mourning, for the older things have passed away. In other words, in that new place where the presence of God shall be, there shall be a new dispensation. And I'm sure you'll agree with me that in this place, at this time, there's so much pain, so much challenges, so much difficulty. You know, this year has begun. We're just into 17, 18 days of the new year? And already there's so much pain. We've lost Eli. We've lost a number of other persons that I have known very personally. And then, of course, there's economic pain. Prices are spiraling. All kinds of social dislocation. Pain in families. Pain at work. But the Word of God tells us in this new place, pain will be history. For we shall have the pleasure and the joy of being in the presence of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. A new place where God's presence shall dwell, and there shall be no longer any pain. But the Word of God tells us that if we're going to be able to become inhabitants of this new place, then we must be willing to persevere. It says that those will inherit, those who are willing to become focused on their own journey, their own life, those who will grit their teeth and bear it, those who are willing to persevere against all odds, in spite of how difficult life becomes, they are going on. I want to submit to you this afternoon that new place is not for individuals who will surrender easily, who will give up, who will pack it in. That new place is for those who are willing to persist through the power of Almighty God, who will say, Lord, I've not been this way before, but if you're going with me, Lord, I'm going. For I want to suggest to all of us that as long as Jesus Christ is with us, then we're able to face every obstacle, every difficulty. Sonny and Sonnel and Addison, the journey up ahead is a difficult one. Losing a father whom you love so dearly is no easy task. But I want to commend you and all the others, the friends of Eli and extended family as well. I want to commend you to the grace of God. I want to say to you that the God that we serve, he is well able to help you as you take this uphill trudge called grief. The God whom we serve will give you the strength that you need to make it every day. Yes, there are times that you will cry, and crying you should. The word tells us that blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. There's absolutely nothing wrong with crying. If this was in church, person would say amen. You can say amen too. There's nothing wrong with crying. As a matter of fact, the word tells us that Jesus wept. When his friend Lazarus died, he cried. That's okay. For I tell persons that tears represent emotional blood. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory even in the midst of life difficulties. Gives us the victory because he came and died on the cruel cross to bring us back to the Father, to ensure our restoration for that which was lost in the Garden of Eden. Jesus Christ restored in the Garden of Gethsemane. And you know how it went. The Word of God tells us that for 3.5 years he lived and did that which was right. But then they crucified him. There was a mock-up trial and they crucified him. But thanks be to God, on the third day he rose from the grave to purchase our redemption so that we can become inhabitants in that new place, in that new garden where there shall be no more pain. You see, between the Garden of Eden and the Garden of New Jerusalem, there's the Garden of Gethsemane, where Jesus Christ died, that we could be restored back to the Father. Thomas asked the question, how do we know the way? How do we ensure that we become participants in this elaborate scheme of mansions and gardens? How do we get there? What is the mechanism for being there, for going there? And Jesus Christ says to him, Thomas, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. And so this evening I want to just remind us that if we want to that day be reunited with the Father in that special place, then we must be willing to do three simple things. One, we must all acknowledge and accept that we are all sinners. Psalm 51 verse 5 tells us that we were born in sin and shapen in iniquity, all of us. Secondly, we must become aware and acknowledge that Jesus Christ died that we may be reunited with the Father. Ask him to forgive us. And thirdly, we must be willing to live our lives according to his will, his plan, and his purpose for us. And if we can do that, then one day we shall be reunited with our Father. The word tells us that on that day, Christ will break the eastern sky And those who are alive and remain shall be caught to meet him in the air. And those who are dead shall also be raised to life with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And so, the resurrection of the dead is the hallmark of the Christian faith. For death is not the end. It is just a doorway into the rest of life. May you, as you have heard the word of God this evening, may each one of us make our calling and election sure. So on that blessed day, we can be reunited with each other and with our Father in the new Jerusalem. May the soul of our dearly departed brother, may his soul rest in peace, and may he rise in glory. Amen. Amen. It's customary for us as members of the Church of Nazarene to say a very special prayer for the family whenever we officiate at funerals, because we are so acutely aware of the immensity of the pain that persons go through when they're grieving. And doing what I do for a living, I'm even more aware of how challenging it can be in terms of grief. And so, at this time, I wanted to say a very special prayer for family and friends of our departed brother, Eli, a prayer of comfort as you go through this time of phenomenal loss. Would you stand with me, please, as we pray? And those of you who understand the power of prayer, you can also pray in your heart as well for these family members. And you can hold hands as well. I think that we're still okay to hold hands and all the sign of solidarity and support. Yes, it's fine. The songwriter asks the question, does Jesus care? Oh, yes, he cares. His heart is touched with our grief. And so, gracious God, this afternoon, you know exactly what each person is going through. Lord, you understand the turmoil and the turbulence of this moment. And Lord, you can identify with their pain. But beyond that, Lord, you can also be that soothing balm as well. Pray, God, even now, that your divine presence, Lord, would surround every mourner, Lord, every family member. Pray, God, you will hold them very close, Lord, at this time. Remind them, oh God, that you care for them, Lord. And Father, I pray that you will provide for them as well. And gracious God, I pray in this hour, Lord, that you will send persons into their lives that will be beacons of hope, Lord, persons that would seek, Lord, to be with them in their most difficult moment, Lord. Person that would be a shoulder to lean on, Father, or hands that would encircle them, Lord. For Lord, you have no hands but our hands, Lord Jesus. Pray, God, that as you will stand with them, Lord, that they will know for sure that you're the God who cares for them as well. May the memories of Eli continue to buoy them up. May his legacy continue, oh Father, to linger with them in a way that motivates them to be the best that they can be, Lord. Gracious God, I commend them into your care. Have your perfect will and way with them this evening. We ask these mercies in Jesus' name with thanksgiving. Amen. 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 Please remain standing. Just want to let you know that the committal has been deferred. They did not get all of the necessary paperwork done. And therefore, we will sing our final hymn. and then we will recede. Father, bless your people. Comfort them in this moment. And may your presence, O God, be so viral to all of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Okay, as you might have seen in your leaflet, there's an envelope in which you can make a contribution to the Heart and Stroke Foundation, but the person who was supposed to come is not here, but we're gonna have a representative stand at the door, so if you wanna make a contribution, the envelopes will be collected. I wanna encourage you to make that contribution this evening, because we never know, we might need those services sometime. But again, the envelope, you can make your contribution. Someone will be at the door collecting the envelopes. Let me just ask that person to step up a minute so you will know who the person. You don't want to give it to the wrong person, right? So this is the person who will collect right here up front. Look up front, right? This person here will collect the envelopes when you go to the back, okay? We're going to do two songs at the end, but as Peter mentioned, there was one special song that Eli seemed to like, and we're going to do this song as we go out. It is well with my soul, and I hope that all of us will be able to say it is well with our soul that we sing this song. It is well with my soul.
Thank you.
fellowship of the Holy Spirit rests and abide with you, now and forevermore. Amen.